you take it. My in-laws are bad. Okay. What is your goal where your in-laws are concerned? What is the actual victory that you seek? A peaceful home, good relationship with your husband, right? Okay. What are the components of that? Every husband comes with in-laws, except you've killed all of them. Even if his mother and his father are dead. There's the auntie, the uncle, the cousins. Even if he's alone, you should be afraid. Yes. If you marry a man who has no family, there's a problem. Because there's nobody to report him to. And if he has no one, that's problematic. What is my point? Your end goal is that your home works, that your relationship with your spouse works in a way that you are at peace to pursue the things of your life that are important to you. The in-laws always come with a husband. So how can you then make that your problem? Because if you're thinking strategically about winning in terms of your relationship with your husband and the support you need to have the liberty to run the race of your life, it then means you must work out a strategy to make the in-laws work too. Why? Because they're part of his life. They came before you. They've known themselves much longer than you. It seems like because we said, I do, I wear a ring. Now I'm king and everybody else is nothing. That's stupid. When you want to play to win, you have to think strategically in terms of what your actual goal is. It's not for the pleasure of gisting with your friends about how you dealt with your in-laws. What's that? What value do you get from that? Except that they'll say, those people are not going to be in your home when there's trouble. So you gain nothing. Stay focused. Remember what is important. What do you want? If you're a career woman, you want the support of your husband. And to keep his support, his influencers are important. Why? Because they speak. And what they say will influence and affect him. And therefore, you must nullify the negative effect that can come from the influencers by embracing them with wisdom. My mother-in-law lived with me for 20 years. Yes. My husband loves his mother. How can I love him and not love her on his behalf? That's the truth. I love my husband. I want my home to work. He loves his mother. Why do I want him to be torn between the two of us? His mother. See, I have three sons. I know a lot of young girls want their mother-in-laws to die. Me, I'm not dying for anybody. So any girl that will marry my sons, she will be blessed because she will be my daughter. I'm not looking for daughter-in-laws. I'm looking for daughters. But if she's hoping that I'll die, her husband is somewhere else, not in my house. So in reality, when you're thinking about your career and your life, but your husband is a part of that. Can he be the only focus? No. Why? Because attached to him is his own family. How do I manage that? What do I need to do? It costs me nothing. Every uncle and Awishika auntie, good morning, uncle, how are you? What's that? Traditional respect is important to them. It costs me nothing. I live my life and I go on. So, they know I'll be kneeling down like choo-choo-choo-choo all over the place. What does it cost me? Nothing. I'm running the race of my life. I have a husband who supports and encourages me. His family is important to him. They're older than me anyway. So I was brought up in my house to respect people that are older than you. So kneeling down to greet somebody, how is that a problem? Okay, so we want to have a host a family in our house. How can that be a problem? We can afford it. So I just make sure everybody's happy. Why? Because you're managing the legacy you leave with each person, one person at a time. You want to win. Don't lose sight of your goal. The Bible says that we must seek wisdom. In seeking wisdom, we must seek understanding. Everything we will have to do is not written for us as 10 commandments. We're going to have to use our brain and extend the principles of God. Love your neighbor as yourself. My in-laws are my neighbors. So at the least, I can love them. I have a sister-in-law that was totally cantankerous. And what my husband says, and maybe she shouldn't come to us and say, no. Your mother lives in our house. She loves her daughter. It's me that will not say her daughter, she loves come and see her. She will come. Ah, but you know, I said, no, don't worry. I can cope. Just leave her. What's my coping mechanism? I just get out of her way. It's true. I'm busy anyway. If she comes to my house and I'm still at home in the morning, my house staff already know. They're just going to keep saying that I'm getting ready. By the time I'm ready, it means I'm coming straight down the stairs and on my way out. And as she said, oh, Mama Ludala, I'm saying, Eka Roma, Ekelema, yes, ma. Echikiniko. And I'm saying, Emma Binuma, when you meet him, Musarilo. You know, and I'm answering her, and the ma doesn't drop. But I'm getting in the car, and before she sees me again, God help her. But there isn't enough time for rancor. Because I don't need it. I need to protect my husband and his peace of mind. And if he has a sister that will cause me pain and therefore cause him trouble, I nullify her effect on me so he can be at peace. And my mother-in-law can be at peace because she can still see her daughter instead of causing war between them. And I get to live my life. And because I travel a lot, I have a lot of house staff. But having my mother-in-law in the house created stability for my children. There was always an adult parent in the house. One day, two house girls can leave. So I had an antidote to that. I always had cousins that were allowed to live with me that I was raising. So that if we went into a crisis mode, there were people to step in and I could still keep to my plans and keep my house working. How do you play to win? Let me tell you a story. When we just got married, we used to live in a house where the landlord and the landlady were living as well. It was on Bade Thomas. Ah. They were not nice to me. Because I think for whatever reason, I think they had a plan for my husband. And he did not include me. And then I showed up on the scene. And they were wondering where this girl came from. And for some reason, they also didn't understand how a young girl already had a manufacturing factory. And it was not her father's company. Their problem, not mine. Because you must know what is important to you. Other people's problem must not become yours. So So if I come home and I greet them, they will not answer me. Especially the woman. So one day my friend's mother, I was lamenting. I said, ah, mommy, you know, I don't even know what to do with these people. But I greet them all every time. Because the way the house was, the front part was the townhouse that they lived in. And the other part were apartments. And we lived in the apartment upstairs. It was an apartment downstairs. I had to pass by there. They always have their door open. They were retired people. So everyone would say, good morning, my aroma. So my friend's mother said, ah, yeah, easy. Working more, I die alone. I thought, for those that don't speak Yoruba, it means you will greet them and you answer yourself. So I said, mommy, how do I do? She said, ole, you just do. I can't run my yes, my other mama, I say, ma. In your head, you will imagine they answered. And you give them the next answer, and you go on and go on with your life. When I get to my next meeting, does anybody know that I answered, I greeted someone that did not answer me? No. If I decide to be angry and carry the anger into a meeting, I will misbehave. How am I going to let somebody else's problem become my problem? How do you play to win? In a workplace, somebody doesn't like you. Sure. Somebody's problem. The Bible says, love your neighbor as yourself. What do you owe that person? Good morning, Mary. How are you? He just says, oh, well, I hope your children are okay. You go on with your life. If you have to work with the person, you will still explain. There's a boss that is harassing you. Especially the one that wants to sleep with you. After you have prayed and you have stoked fire on his head, you go into his office and you shut the door. And you tell him, sir, please never ever speak to me about that again. Ever. If you do it, you'll be shocked at how I will react. You'll be shocked at what I will do. You have nothing. You shut the door. After you finish, you say, thank you, sir. You open the door and you go out. And every time you see him thereafter, good morning, sir. How are you? Frustrate him with the sir. Sometimes people run away from a place that they know is good for their career. For what? You will do your job in that kind of place so that there's no excuse. But if there's no system in that place that will protect you, you shut the door on the guy and you tell him, by the time I'm done, even you will not know what happened to you. So don't you ever try me again. Open the door and say, thank you, sir. He'll be afraid of you. Doesn't know if you're a witch, a wizard. See, there is wisdom in life. And one of the things you must do is you must protect your integrity with everything that you have.